everyone. I'm Dr. Himali Kapania Hanuja. I am cataract and refractive surgeon at Sadhu Kamal Eye Hospital, Bombay Central. Today I'm going to speak about laser vision correction. So we come across a lot of people wearing glasses and contact lenses, and they want to get rid of them. So these the glasses which they wear come from four types of refractive errors. The first refractive error and the most common in younger age group is known as myopia. It is nearsightedness. In this, the patients, they wear long distance glasses, that is minus number glasses. The second refractive error that comes is hypermetropia. In this is known as farsightedness. In this, the person is able to see distance, and for near, they require a plus number. The third type of refractive error is astigmatism. Astigmatism is corrected with the help of cylinders. The fourth refractive error is presbyopia. Presbyopia usually occurs in an older age group. In that, patients are not able to read near objects. Okay, usually it occurs after 40 years of age. So there are surgeries available to correct all these kinds of refractive errors. And these surgeries help us to get freedom from our glasses as well as freedom from contact lenses. This is known as refractive or laser vision correction. The types of surgeries that are available, they can be done either over the cornea, that is the front part of the eye, or they can be done over the lens, that is the back part of the eye. So the surgeries available over the cornea include most commonly LASIK surgery. The second surgery that is available is a photorefractive keratectomy, that is a PRK surgery. The third surgery which is available is a SMILE surgery. These are cornea-based procedures. The second option that can happen in patients who cannot undergo a cornea-based procedure is a lens-based procedure. In lens-based procedure, we insert another lens in front of the normal lens of the eye. So these are known as phakic IOLs or ICLs. The second option that is available in a lens-based procedure is a refractive lens exchange. In patients who have a very high refractive error, where a single cornea-based procedure or lens-based procedure is not available, in such cases, we might require both cornea as well as lens-based procedures to be done on that patient. Okay? So now, which patients can undergo a refractive surgery? So for undergoing a refractive surgery, there are certain requirements. The most important requirement is that the person should be above 18 years of age, preferably above 21 years of age, because the refractive error becomes stable after 18 years of age. Okay, it can go on till 60 years, or I have seen people getting it done even after 70 years of age. But the person should be above 18 years. Second thing is that their refractive error should be constant for 6 months or to 1 year of age. Third thing, they should be non-pregnant or not lactating. Fourth, they should not have any diabetes, hypertension, any systemic problem, autoimmune disease, collagen vascular disease. Fifth, they should not have any damage to the eye. So something like an high intraocular pressure or glaucoma, what is known as kalamotia, or a corneal scarring on the front part of the eye, or a cataract. In such situations, we do not ask them to undergo a refractive surgery. Some of them are relative contraindications, like a person who has a squint or a person who has a nystagmus. In such situations, they are not the first choice for a refractive surgery. Also, whenever we are advising refractive surgery in a patient, patients should understand that the surgery also has its own side effects. So they should have very realistic expectations, and they should know about the risks of the surgery. If they are willing to undertake all the risks, they can go ahead with the surgery. There is a comprehensive test that needs to be done before surgery. It is important to do these tests to decrease the amount of complications post the surgery. The most important test that needs to be done is a refraction number checking test, vision checking. That needs to be done before dilatation and can be done post dilatation also after putting drops. So we need to repeat it twice, pre and post dilatation. Second thing that needs to be done is an auto refractometer reading to check the refraction which we have got, and an auto K reading to check the anterior curvature of the cornea if a person is undergoing a cornea based procedure. Also, it is important to undergo a white to white measurement, a pupil size measurement, more importantly, a mesopic pupil size measurement. Mesopic pupil size is the size of the pupil in dim light. It is important because if someone has a very high or very large mesopic pupil size, the person might have glare post any refractive surgery. So we check the pupil size prior to the surgery. Also, eye pressure measurement should be done so that if a person has glaucoma, they should not undergo the refractive surgery. Another more important test that needs to be done in a patient prior to a refractive surgery is a topography test or a tomography test. This test helps us to find out how the surface of the cornea is. Is the surface regular or is the surface irregular? A tomography will also tell us about the posterior surface of the cornea. Any irregularity in the posterior surface of the cornea is a relative contraindication for a refractive surgery. We also check the corneal thickness. So a corneal thickness of less than 450 microns in the center is a relative contraindication for the refractive surgery. Again, we have to take into consideration the refractive error. Other tests include dry eye tests. Dry eyes are common post any surgery, and they are more common post a refractive surgery. So we do a proper dry eye evaluation. We also do a good slit lamp evaluation, extraocular muscles evaluation to rule out any squint. We also dilate the patient to check the back part of the eye, that is the retina, to see if there is any breaks or holes which need to be treated prior to the refractive surgery. So, as we have already discussed, the patient who is above 18 years of age, who has a stable refractive error for more than 1 year, who has a residual corneal thickness post the surgery of more than 250 microns, or who has a preoperative corneal thickness of more than 450 microns, who doesn't have a flat or a very steep cornea, a person who has a normal topography, not a suspicious topography, a person who has who doesn't have glaucoma, corneal scarring, any extreme dryness of the eye, squint, who doesn't have autoimmune disease, collagen vascular disease, diabetes. If a person wears contact lenses, then depending on the type of contact lens, if the person wears a soft contact lens, then the person needs to remove the contact lens 1 to 2 weeks prior to the surgery. If a person wears a hard or a rigid contact lens, they need to remove the contact lens 3 to 4 weeks prior to surgery. Now, after all this is done, and everything goes by plan, for if in a cornea-based procedure, we can correct a myopia refractive error up to 10 to 12 diopters, depending on the corneal thickness, a hypermetropic refractive error up to 6 diopters, and astigmatism up to 6 diopters. If a refractive error is higher than a myopic refractive error, more than 10 diopters, or a hypermetropic and astigmatic refractive error, more than 6 diopters, in such a situation, we need to go for a lens-based procedure or a combined lens and cornea-based procedure to correct the entire refractive error. Now, I'll be showing you some animations of the surgeries which we have spoken about. Okay. One more thing I would want to speak about is a Munnerlin's formula. Munnerlin's formula helps us to calculate the ablation depth. So it is calculated as 1/3 into the optical zone square into the intended correction in diopters. So the ablation depth is directly proportional to the square of optical zone that we take during the surgery. This is only for cornea-based procedure. So roughly, if we take, we are correcting one diopter of the refractive error. For a 6 mm optical zone, the ablation depth is around 13 microns. When we increase it to 7 mm optical zone, it increases to 17 microns, and so on and so forth. What is percentage tissue alteration or percentage tissue alter, PTA? Percentage tissue alter is basically flap thickness plus the ablation depth divided by the central corneal thickness. The percentage tissue altered for a cornea-based procedure should be less than 40% to decrease the chances of corneal ectasia post the refractive surgery or cornea weakening post the refractive surgery. Okay, now we go ahead with the surgery videos. So I start with the LASIK surgery video, that is with blade or a microkeratome LASIK surgery. As you can see here, a microkeratome is used to cut the superficial part of the cornea, that is a flap, which is attached at a part known as the hinge. The flap is then lifted up and a laser, excimer laser, is placed over the cornea to correct the refractive error. Okay, so here the excimer laser is cutting or ablating the cornea and correcting the refractive error required. Then we deposit the flap back. This is the blade laser surgery. Now the second surgery is the bladeless LASIK surgery. This is a femtosecond LASIK surgery. In this, instead of using a blade, a femtosecond laser is used to create a flap. So here the femtosecond laser will be creating a flap. As you can see, the flap has been lifted up. And then the excimer laser will ablate the cornea and correct the refractive error that needs to be corrected. After the refractive error is corrected, again the flap is deposited back. So there is no suture that is required, no lens that is required post surgery. Is the PRK surgery. So in this PRK surgery, there is no flap that is created. In this, the superficial part of the cornea is removed, that is known as the epithelium. So it is removed either with the help of alcohol. So with the help of alcohol, Hevel, it is loosened, the superficial part is loosened. Or it can be removed with the help of a blade. Or it can be removed with the help of an excimer laser directly over the superficial part. After that, the excimer laser is used to correct the refractive error. But here, because the superficial part of the cornea is removed, we need to cover it with a lens for at least 3 days, and the patient has to wear a lens for 3 days after surgery. The new cornea-based procedure that I'm talking about is a SMILE procedure. In this, there is no flap and no removal of the epithelium. A laser, femtosecond laser, is used to create a small lenticule inside the cornea. And using a small cut, using a femtosecond laser and a micro forceps, that lenticule is removed from the cornea through the corneal pocket. So this has a very fast recovery rate, as there is no flap, there is no removal of the epithelium, no lens required. So this is very fast and the latest technique. These were all the corneal based procedures. Next we go to the lens-based procedure. In the lens-based procedure, this is how an ICL is implanted. Here, the eye is dilated, pupil is dilated, and through a small incision, a lens is put behind the black part of the eye and in front of the normal lens of the eye. Then, pupil is constricted. So here, the lens, ICL lens, is in front of the normal lens of the eye. So what do patients experience? after a refractive surgery, mostly after a corneal refractive surgery. They can have some amount of watering, irritation. Irritation is more common in patients with PRK who have a lens inside their eye for at least 3 days. There can be some amount of pain on the first day of surgery, which can be treated with the help of tablets or with the help of drops. Some patients can have an occasional mild redness. There can be slight sensitivity to bright light and also mild hazy vision on the day of surgery. From the second day, the vision starts clearing up in case of LASIK and SMILE. For PRK, it takes at least a week for the vision to clear up. So what are the precautions that we can take while undergoing a cornea-based refractive surgery? First thing, post the surgery, the patients need to instill the drops properly as advised by the doctor. Clean the eyes after instilling the drops. Try not to exert or strain the eyes. You can watch TV, read books from this day after the surgery, so the second day. But the computers need to be used, computers and mobiles, from the third day can be used. Try using sunglasses while going in the bright light, because some bright light sensitivity can be available, can be there. Also, patients are requested not to rub their eyes, protect their eyes from dust. So sometimes we give some protective goggles to protect the eyes from any dust. Head bath or splashing water over the eyes needs to be avoided for at least 2 weeks. Swimming needs to be started only after 2 weeks. Any vigorous mild exercise can be started after a week, mild exercise and driving. But any weight lifting exercise needs to be started after a month only. So each surgery has complications. Same way, refractive surgery also has its share of complications. But the number of complications have drastically reduced if after taking a good patient history and with a good preclinical examination. So relatively, refractive surgeries have now become a relatively safe option, especially the corneal-based refractive surgeries. So this is my card. I work at Sadhu Kamal Eye Hospital. I have done my refractive PECO and refractive fellowship from Narayan Netralaya, Bangalore. And I work at Bombay Central from 10 to 7. So if you have any queries regarding the refractive surgery, you can come and contact me. And thank you for your patience.